We study through books of the Bible here at the Village Chapel, and we're starting a new book study today in the New Testament book of Hebrews. If you would like a copy and you do not have one with you, and you'd like one, just raise up your hand. Somebody will come around, and that way you can have something to follow along. We're calling this study The Incomparable Christ. Because certainly the book of Hebrews focuses in on Jesus. It's Christologically rich, as theologians would say. And these first four verses that we're going to study today in particular. Now, what do we mean by incomparable? If you look the word up, you'll find some synonyms. Matchless, unrivaled, unparalleled, peerless, superlative. He's unique in every way. He is sui generis. He is one of a kind. There's nothing, there's no other person like him that's ever existed. There's no entity like him that's ever existed. He is in a category all his own. And that may or may not be the Jesus that you have trusted and believed in, hoped in, thought was a part of your faith before. So we'll explore that together as we go through this book, especially the book of Hebrews, because of its richness in that regard. We will see that Jesus is the center of history. And we know that. Anybody would know that just looking at the Western calendar, the way it was set up, even though it's a few years off because Dionysius Exiguus in the 6th century didn't know what we know about when Herod the Great died. But when he fixed the date for the Western calendar. It was fixed around the life of Jesus Christ. So it's AD, BC, and Jesus is all a part of our thinking, and all of history has been sort of, he's the pivot point, he's the axis point, if you will. Why is that? Why a poor peasant, you know, from a pass-through nation, in an insignificant, really, time in history? Why has that person had such lasting impact on the world to be the center of history? He's certainly the focus of Scripture. We'll see that as we go through the book of Hebrews. You'll see the author quotes the Old Testament at least 30 times directly, and more times than that, if you will, indirectly. And he's the sovereign of destiny. You'll see that even in these first four verses. That will become clear to us. Today will be a bit of an introduction to Hebrews, if you will. And we'll dive into those first four verses. But there are at least a few things that I'd like to begin with just to set it up a little bit to show you how valuable I think it is. Philip Hughes has one of the best of the modern commentaries on the book of Hebrews. He says, the serious study of the epistle to the Hebrews cannot fail to have a powerfully beneficial effect on the personal life of the individual Christian and on the corporate well-being of the church. It is a tonic for the spiritually debilitated. I don't know if your spiritual life is like mine. Mine undulates from time to time. I'm just being upfront and honest with you. I'm sometimes in a trough and debilitated in some way spiritually, feeling dry or feeling like there's just nothing there, feeling like my prayers are bouncing off the ceiling, whatever. Opening the Bible, but just feeling a little lackluster as I try to read it, you know? Coming to church, even though I don't feel like it that morning. And I work here, you know, so it's like, I gotta be here, you know? But Hebrews, yeah, a tonic for the spiritually debilitated, for the spiritually, those who are occasionally undulating in their spiritual life. If that's you, Hebrews, I think you'll find it a refreshing oasis in your life as we study together. Now, a couple of things that we are worth looking at whenever you start a book study, the literary genre of a book, it's grouped with the New Testament letters. However, I would say that Hebrews lacks some of the characteristics of the ancient letters. It doesn't have an opening salutation with the authorial ID. It doesn't say Paul and Timothy to the churches at. So there's no opening that says who wrote it, who it's addressed to, who the recipients of this letter might be. So even though it's called the Epistle to the Hebrews in a lot of your English Bibles, I'm not sure that the idea of it being from the literary genre of letter is actually all that clear to us. May have been a sermon or a treatise or an essay that was written down and then got circulated. It does close a little bit. It's got some epistolary characteristics at the end of it. But the beginning doesn't have that at all. And even as you read through it, there's so much exhortation. It sounds like something that was delivered orally as a sermon, perhaps, or a treatise, or an essay that was circulated, like I say. Who's the author? And I know all of you are waiting. I've had several of you email, are we going to find out who wrote Hebrews? And a couple of you are putting a little bit of pressure on me. You're thinking, hey, man, you know, we're not tied to any one stream of the church, one denomination or anything like that. We ought to be able to figure this out because we're not having to parrot whatever somebody said ahead of us, you know, or whatever along the way. So who wrote Hebrews? Well, the author is not identified. That's true. Like I said, there's no salutation. There are a lot of possibilities for a long, long time. First, really, 1,500 years of the church. A lot of people believed it was Paul, that Paul was the one who wrote. As a matter of fact, I think there may be several of your English Bible translations that will say that it's Paul's letter. Luke is another one that's been suggested. Timothy is mentioned in Hebrews. And so if, and I say if, because if that's the same Timothy that hung out with Paul, but who's to say it is? But if that is, well, it could be Luke. That's true. Could be Epaphras. It could be Barnabas. It could be Apollos. There's so many different names that have been raised. Emmaus Road Disciples. I heard that one this week in some of the research I was doing. I went, awesome. I always wondered what those guys thought. And if they sat down after, you know, being walking with Jesus and he unfolded all these things and explained all these things, I wondered if somebody sat down and made a few notes, you know. I like that idea, but it's more just, I like it. There's zero really evidence that that's exactly who the author of Hebrews. Some have suggested a woman, perhaps Priscilla. Remember Priscilla and Aquila, and they instructed Apollos together in a more excellent way in terms of his understanding of the gospel. Perhaps Priscilla, some have suggested. I think there's probably some evidence that it was a male that actually wrote this in terms of some of the pronouns and some of the language that's used. Some of the clues that we do have, the author of Hebrews quotes the Old Testament at least 30 times, like I said. So evidently, this person knows their Old Testament, whoever the writer of Hebrews is. The Greek is a bit more polished, according to Greek experts, than any of Paul's letters. And that's one of the reasons that after the Reformation and since the Reformation, most people have discounted Paul as the author of Hebrews. So who is it if this Greek is so polished? Who might it be? Might be one of the arguments for Apollos to be the author of the Hebrews, simply because we know he was very strong in his languages. There are 150 Greek words that are used in the book of Hebrews that are not found in any of Paul's writings. That's a pretty significant argument against Paul being the author of Hebrews. As I say, from the Reformation and on throughout to our own time, Pauline authorship is almost universally rejected. The rhetorical style of Hebrews is that of a master. Paul acknowledged that he himself was not a trained speaker in 2 Corinthians 11. In addition, Hebrews 2:3 states, the author received the gospel indirectly from those who heard him, meaning Christ. Paul claims to have received the gospel directly through a revelation of Jesus Christ, according to Galatians. So again, I think probably not Paul, but I'm not sure we know who. Another clue from Hebrews itself, we know the author was acquainted with Timothy, as I said earlier. Could have been any one of those circle of friends. But the author is familiar as well with Jewish practices and the sacrificial system, quite familiar with all of that. It's fair to conclude that the author was a Jew. And from their skillful use of Greek, we can surmise that they were well-educated and probably wealthy. All of that said, and all of that considered, I got to go with Origen, the church father, early church father from the 3rd century. And this is what he said. Who wrote the epistle? In truth, only God knows. That may not be satisfying to you, but I think it's got to be for us if we're going to be honest about what we can't know and don't know. And it's really okay. It doesn't change what it says. And what it says is more important, I think, than who wrote it. How about date? Do we know when it was written? Well, the Old Covenant practices the priestly system, the sacrificial system, some of that's all referred to. And yet there's no mention of the cataclysmic event that occurred in 70 AD when the Romans destroyed Jerusalem and destroyed the temple itself, that place where that center of worship for Jews, where the sacrifices were offered. No mention of that whatsoever. And you would think there would be, because Hebrews is actually mentioned by Clement of Rome as early as 95 AD. Clement of Rome quotes from Hebrews. So it's real close to that time when that cataclysmic event happened, if he's quoting it, and if it had time to circulate all around. Remember, back then, they couldn't just email or text an attachment to anyone. Somebody had to carry it. And for somebody to make a copy of it took a long, long time. There was no copy, cut, and paste. And so all of that requires a lot of time. So you have to back up the date of Hebrews, I think, to really a time before 70 AD, especially since there's no mention of that cataclysmic event, and yet all those references to Old Testament sacrifice and all of that. I'm going to say somewhere in the mid-60s, not the 1960s, not the Beatles 60s. I'm going to say the first 60s, you know, the early 60s, the original 60s. And somewhere in there is going to be, I think, a pretty good guess on when Hebrews was written. Who are the recipients? Unknown with any precision, but what's clear is that they were Hebrew or Jewish Christians. That's clear from just reading it. You understand they are people who have heard the gospel, most of which have come to believe the gospel. Some are wobbling in their faith. And that's one of the reasons why I find a book like this, it just resonates timelessly, even with folk in our day and time as well. Folks who have access now, all of us, because of the internet, we've got access to all kinds of ideas, and we live in a pluralistic society, and there's a whole lot of different concepts of who God is and what salvation might mean, and whether or not human persons are actually sinners or not, which, by the way, I think is the most provable doctrine of the Christian faith. That I'm a sinner, that you're a sinner, that we need redemption. I think that's the most provable, because we can see it on the street, as G.K. Chesterton said, we can see it in the mirror, as others have said. Who are the recipients? I think they're Jews by nationality who have converted to Christianity and they're followers of Jesus, but some of them are wobbling, and that's important for us to know. What is the occasion and purpose of Hebrews? This one's a little more complicated. All right, so during that time, Judaism was a religio licita. That means it is in the Roman Empire, and Tertullian is the one that sort of coined that phrase later, but it's a religion that is permitted within the political power structure and social structure of the Roman Empire. Judaism was permitted. And at first, the Christian movement was seen as a subset of Judaism. And so at the first, the Romans allowed the free movement and discussion and all that sort of thing, because they thought this was just a subgroup of Judaism, which they allowed to be a religion practiced. As it became clear that the two, Judaism and Christianity, were not the same thing, and that happened over time and down through years and years and decades, then it became clear that these Christians are not indeed members, subgroup of the Jews. And therefore, so you have people like Claudius in 49, who's the emperor in 49 AD, who kicks out all of the Jewish Christians and all of the Jews from Rome because of the friction that's happening between them. And this may have been, you know, one of the reasons why there's a reference to those from Italy in the book of Hebrews. There may be, it may be the displaced ones who are Italian and they got displaced from Rome. At the same time, it might be a reference from some who were displaced and they're writing, and whoever their author is writing to the believers who have remained in Italy somehow, amidst some level of persecution. So there's lots of different options as to the occasion and purpose of it, as well as who the recipients might be, who the author might be. One thing that is for sure, the overall themes in Hebrews really arise not only from those difficulties and from the struggles of those Christians, those Jewish Christians who are wobbling a little bit. But here comes the author reminding them in the themes that he writes about, or exactly who Jesus Christ was and is, reminding them of the true nature of Jesus, that he's actually the Son of God, not just another one of many religious leaders or world religion leaders. Very unique, very different. He's actually God, the Son of God. And that's underscored over and over again. We'll see it even in these first four verses. And that it really means something if you say he's the Son of God. That if he came actually to pay the price on the cross for our sins and died for us, and suffered and died for us, it changes not only our view of salvation, but our view of suffering as well. And here, these believers that are suffering a bit now, as we read Hebrews, we sense that that's happening, that they've endured some suffering. And so how can they navigate that? And they start to see some of their number drop out. Some of you are familiar with the passages in Hebrews that refer to this. And some of them drop out. Were they believers ever? They're dropping out. They're abandoning the faith. Some of them are reverting back to Judaism. And it's a good question to ask and good for us to as we study all of that. What does that say about God? What does that say about whether he holds us fast? Or whether it's up to us to hold him fast? These are good questions that we'll have to talk through as we go through Hebrews. Some of the other issues, how did the promises of God in the Old Testament connect and find their fulfillment in Jesus? We'll see that throughout Hebrews. In what ways is Jesus the ultimate prophet, priest, and king? That's really going to be very clear to us as we study Hebrews. What does it mean to be a genuine Christian believer? Not just somebody who's wearing the jersey and is a fan in the stands, and sometimes a fickle fan in the stands. I mean, I used to live in Philadelphia, man. I remember what it was like when things weren't going well. And man, as a Philadelphian, I joined in with the herd in the crowd, and we let the team know if they weren't doing well. We cheered for them when they were winning, but man, we booed for them when they weren't. Wearing our jerseys and booing for them, you know? So wearing the jersey, is that the same thing as being on the team? Sitting in the stands, is that the same thing as being on the team or not? And those are good questions. We'll wrestle with that kind of stuff. Is what does it mean to be a genuine Christian believer? And how should that impact us when we're suffering? When we're facing difficulties, we still have to go through all of that in our day and time as well. So Hebrews is relevant in our time just as much as it was back then. And then how should we respond to other believers that we see wobbling in their faith? That's helpful to me to have a book that speaks to that kind of thing. Because we all, I mean, I bet you every single one of you who claim to be a professing Christian probably knows somebody who even used to come to this church who has in some way turned their back on the faith or turned away from Christ. How do we help those folks if we can? How do we respond in such situations? And how do we even watch out for ourselves as we confront the different kinds of things we do in the culture that we live in, the pluralistic culture that we live in, the darkened world that we live in, just like they lived in a darkened world and a very pluralistic world as well. All right, so we have all of that. Let me give you one of my favorite commentaries that I've been reading is The Unshakable Kingdom by David Gooding. And this is such an encouragement. This then is a question this letter will confront us with. Are we genuine believers? Do we really believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Are we behaving in everyday affairs, and especially in religious contexts, in a way that is straightforwardly consistent with our professed belief? Does it matter? Do you believe in the existence of God? That's wonderful. That's one thing. But does it matter that you believe in the existence of God? And does the God you believe in just sort of some sort of construction of your imagination? Or is it as the culture has defined God? Or is it some movie or some popular book, fiction book? Or is the God that you believe in, the Jesus that you believe in specifically, is that the real Jesus of history? The real Jesus that we just celebrated in our sort of national / religious holiday that we call Christmas? Is it just a bit of romanticism and warm fuzzies, or was there a real Jesus that really lived, really came from heaven, really came, died on the cross, and rose again from the grave? And what difference does all that make? That really, has it got some kind of impact on us? All right, with all that said, here's the outline in advance for the first four verses. You ready? Pretty easy, huh? You guys are thinking, yeah, this is going to be a breeze. Watch. Okay, let's see. God, it starts in verse 1 here. And by the way, God is the title of the being that we call the supreme entity, none other like him. There's none greater than him. He's in a category all his own. And he's mentioned 68 times by that title in this book. So you can be assured that God is at the center of this study, okay? God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, or in Son. His isn't actually there. It's in italics in most of your, or some of your Bibles might say in a Son, or some of your may say the Son, but the definite article is not there. It's just in Son. Whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world. Do you realize what a bold claim that is? And he, meaning the Son, is the radiance of his glory, not the reflection of his glory, not the moon reflecting the sun, but he's actually a part of the sun itself in the metaphor. I think the moon is, I mean, how many of us run to the window when we see that big moon out there? Awesome! But its light is not its own. It's reflecting light. Jesus is not reflecting the radiant, or the light of God's glory. He is the radiance. He's a part of the source. Really powerful there. And he's also the exact representation of his, meaning God's nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. That includes a chair you're sitting on right now. It includes the gravity that holds us to this planet. It includes the comets that are racing through space right now. It includes the food you will eat for lunch. Some of you, most of you, okay. He holds all things together by the word of his power. When he had made purification of sins, in other words, washed them away, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Jesus did this. Having become as much better than the angels, as he has inherited a more excellent name than they. That's what I call flourless cake, folks. It's thick, it's dense, it's rich. I mean, there's so much there, we're going to do 2 weeks on it. Don't be afraid. It's really great. Revelation, God has spoken through the Old Testament prophets. That's true. Hebrews respects that. Hebrews quotes from the Old Testament, like I say, 30 times, and connects the dots and says, the same God that spoke back then continues to speak, but as he's going to do some contrasting, and he's going to say the God that spoke back then with promises and predictions has fulfilled all of that in the person of Christ. But that he speaks at all is just amazing to me. I think most of the people that believe in God would at least acknowledge that whatever we can do, if he really did create us, he should also be able to do. In other words, something greater can't come from something lesser. So that if you and I can think, put string sentences and thoughts together and concepts, and we can actually speak and communicate, then the God who has designed us and made us in some way has got to be able to do all of that in a far superior way than we can. Now, most people don't talk about that sort of thing. Most people prefer the God who's the battery, sort of the impersonal God that's just animating life, and that we can sort of put on the end of some puppet strings so we can manipulate and control him. And I know there's tons of you have heard the argument that all religions are just a power play. Well, so is that view. That view of religion is a power play as well. So that's kind of a circular argument. But if everything is a power play, let me just suggest to you that this particular Christian faith, where God himself sets aside the comforts of heaven and comes to become one of us, and as we learned in Mark chapter 10, came not to be served, that's a power play, but he came to serve. Well, now that is a different story. And the gospel is not a demand, it's an offer. This is God saying, I will do for you what you cannot do for yourself. I'm not asking you to follow all these rules, and then if you balance out the moral scales, you then are acceptable to me. That's not the Christian faith at all. That is pretty much every other religious belief system, but that's not the Christian faith. And that's why it's good news. Because this guy up here, and to be honest, all of you out there, none of us can follow all the rules. None of us are that good. Some of you are, you know, you've heard people say before, I don't need to say anything about God. I don't need a witness. I just let my life speak. Sorry, I doubt it. You're not quite that good. It's not going to be that clear. And look, I get paid to be good. Y'all have to be good for nothing. I don't think any of us are good enough. And so we do need to speak. And what we have to speak is good news, that what we could not do for ourselves, he has come to do for us. Didn't just send, yes, in space-time history, he sent angels and prophets and visions and dreams and all that stuff. Got it. And foreshadowed what was going to be fulfilled in the person of Jesus when God himself came. And we just went through this period of time last month where we were supposedly celebrating the incarnation, and where it's sort of a part of maybe some of our holiday experiences and our, but here's the God that reveals himself, okay? Here's the God that was a part of creation, this person, Jesus Christ. Hebrews tells us that. By whom all things were made. So Hebrews 1, John's Gospel 1, and the letter to the Colossians, Colossians 1, all three agree the Son of God was involved in the creation event itself. John 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. In the beginning sounds a lot like another book, Genesis. In the beginning, God, the Word was, past tense, was already with God. And the Word was God. And John goes on to spell it out that the Word, the living Word of God, is Jesus himself, the Son of God, Jesus. The same one that Hebrews 1 is talking about, that Colossians 1 talks about, is the creator of all things. In other words, folks, you're not just some kind of happy accident. You're not just the random co-location of atoms and chemicals. As a human person, you even wonder what life is all about. Where did everything come from? You have all those philosophical questions in your mind that have arisen, you know, whenever you got to the place where you started thinking laterally and trying to figure out some of these sort of, you know, deeper thoughts in life. You started thinking, well, where did everything come from? Does life have any meaning at all? Is it really just about getting a paycheck? Is that all it's about? Just grabbing everything I can grab? And yet it all leaves us wanting more, something more. And what the Bible teaches us is that the thing we're desiring so much, that we're longing for so deeply, is him. The one who created us, the one who made us, the one who designed us and put eternity in our hearts. So he's involved in creation, and he's created us for himself. And as Augustine said, we're going to be restless until we find our rest in him. And that's why the author of Hebrews wants to present Christ as this unique creator involved in the creation event and the creator of everything that exists. He holds it all together. We'll explore that more. Redemption is also talked about here as well, when he made purification for our sins, verse 3. So that's what priests did, and that's here's where his Jewish roots are kind of showing a little bit. Because at the temple and the tabernacle before it, the priests would offer the sacrifices. And the high priest once a year would go into the Holy of Holies. They tied a little rope to his ankle in case he died in the presence of God. They could just drag his body back out. But the priest's job was to go before God representing the people and to offer some kind of sacrifice and atonement for their sin. The prophet's job was to speak the word of the Lord to the people, to speak for God to the people. The priest is representing the people to God. And here we have this idea that Jesus made purification for our sins, that he not only is, and we'll explore this way more in latter chapters, but not only is he the ultimate high priest, but he's also the sacrifice. He's both the priest and the sacrifice. And again, this is why he is unique in all ways. What Christ did, how he did it, what he did, he provided purification for our sins. How did he do it? It says right here, after he, that is personally, he, to what degree did he do it? He sat down and he made purification for our sins, all of them. And that's why we can come to the table and say thanks as we will today. And so the incomparable Christ is the ultimate prophet, priest, and king. I'll throw up on the screen here. He's the prophet through whom God's final word has come. He's the priest who has made purification for our sins. And he's the king enthroned at God's right hand. Notice how in verses 1 through 4, the contrast, the teaching by contrast, God spoke in the past versus he's now speaking in these last days. It's right there in verse 1. And in verse 1, 2, and 3, and 4, we have he spoke to the forefathers versus he speaks to us. He spoke in the prophets. Now he's speaking in his son. He spoke at many times in various ways, and now he's speaking with this precision through Christ. The precision of the radiance of his glory, it's not reflected, it's not distorted by reflection, it's actually the source, and he's the exact representation of God's nature. See that contrast there? Not many times in various ways anymore, but actually with great precision. You can count on it. God has spoken finally and ultimately in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. Raymond Brown said, Christ's essential work for man has been effectively accomplished. Our part is to hear, believe, obey, and share this word of abundant life. And indeed, that's what we'll do as we go through the study of the book of Hebrews. In, through, and behind the three images, prophet, priest, and king, the roles of the incomparable Christ, we learn that God has an agenda. What is God's agenda? He's seeking a people he can call his own. He's in pursuit of a people he can call his own. And he's haunting some of you in ways he has not done before, haunting you and calling to you. The question is, what do we do? How do we respond? And is the Jesus we believe in this same Jesus that Hebrews talks about, that the rest of the New Testament presents to us as the focus of Scripture, the center of history, and the sovereign of our destiny? I hope that he is. God is engaged in a stunning love affair, William Lane says in his commentary in the book of Hebrews. In the person of the Son, God exposes himself as incarnate to satisfy our need to grasp him with our sense, to see him, to listen to him, to touch him. All this we have in Christ, who has come, not because he owed it to us, but because he loved us. Not because we had a claim on him, but because he took the initiative in his plan set in motion a long, long time ago to redeem a lost world of sinners, among whom I count myself and you as well. He came for me. He came for you. It wasn't a power play. It was a serving play. He came to offer something to us, not to demand something from us. It was a power play in another way, wasn't it? The most powerful thing that ever happened. He is the great reversal artist because he's reversed even the power of death itself, our last and greatest enemy. Jesus reversed that by rising again from the grave, thus validating all of what we're going to read about him in the book of Hebrews and all of what we read about him in the New Testament as well. That's why the resurrection is a part of every single preachment in the book of Acts, because the idea that someone could rise again from the dead blew everyone's mind. And I think that carried like wind in the sails, that carried the gospel around the Mediterranean. as people were looking for, longing for, hoping for a God that could save, that was mighty to save and generous to save like this God is. I wonder, is this the same Jesus that you believe in? I wonder if this is the same Jesus that you trust and hope in, the Jesus who's at the center of God's revelation, the center of creation, and the center of redemption. I pray and hope that it is. I'll seek to persuade you along the way more and more that he is the one. You need look no further. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for who you are and that you came. We are humbled in gratitude for the gift you have given us of yourself and the gift of salvation in your name. It is an act of sheer grace. We didn't deserve it. We are guilty of sin ourselves, each and every one of us, and we need outside help. We can't do this on our own. So we come before you as we come to this table to give you thanks, to offer our gratitude to you. Your body was broken, your blood was shed on our behalf, that the price for our sins could be paid. The purification of our sins was actually accomplished in the person and work of Jesus, to whom we will give thanks here today. We bless you and praise you. We thank you for the good work that you're doing in individual lives here and corporately with this church. We ask you to continue to do that in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Amen and amen.